Hello, I am Norm Ryder. From March 14, 2016 to March 17, 2016, I was on a hunger strike refusing not only food but also liquids to protest the way Worksafe WCAT treats injured workers' claims, as well as the refusal on the part of Worksafe to advise workers of the large radius of the danger zone around radiation emitting devices, and in particular the extent of danger around rooftop antennas. Yes, the no liquids was part of an accelerated plan, but after 5 years of battle with WorkSafe practice, patience has run short. I've suspended the protest fast for the weekend and will resume the fast on Monday. This weekend I will prepare this video outlining some of the more egregious issues or examples of how WorkSafe WCAT have not followed the process with respect to my claim. One could extrapolate the same issues with different data details through to hundreds and even thousands of workers in BC. WorkSafe was originally set up as a no-fault insurance crown corporation to look after workplace health and safety and the needs of workers injured on the job. They operate as an insurance company that assigns full fault to the injured worker in a manner similar to guilty until proven innocent. With a decision made behind closed doors on inadequate, incorrect information without the injured worker present. I have spoken with many injured workers who have similar experiences to mine. I can no longer remain silent. The only question to ask is why has WorkSafe WCAT been allowed to stray so far from the responsibilities that an injured worker feels the need to make a spectacle of themselves to bring the pattern of WorkSafe et al. Abuses to the public. The disfigurement on the left side of my face is the aftermath of surgeries to remove a brain tumor, an acoustic neuronal tumor, which was caused by a massive dose of electromagnetic radiation in the extremely close near field. The issue of intensity or size of the dose is at the heart of my dispute with WorkSafe WCAT. All documents in this video will be ones that are on my WorkSafe WCAT file. At the time of the initial intake interview with case manager Mr. David Krantz, on February 2, 2011, I stated words to the effect, assuming my information is correct, I was hit with the intensity of in excess of 4.8 watts. Mr. Krantz noted the information as he states that he has done some calculations and predicts the equipment in question was transmitting a 4.8 watt output, close but missing an important and essential part of the conditional value. Also, WorkSafe does not allow an injured worker to be considered to be an expert for their own claim. I provided the information under the impression I was a non-expert, as any expert looking at the information would notice the units I expressed the value in were wrong. They should have been expressed in terms of watts per square meter or watts per square centimeter, an intensity then that would be 10,000 times larger. On April 7th, on file April 12th, 2011, I submitted a corrected calculation, the value of which was correct, but I still had the units wrong, a point that any person that professed to be an expert in radiation and how it affects biological tissue would notice. On April 26th, 2 weeks after the April 7th letter was on file, Dr. Sammy Wakeem produced his medical opinion, where he stated, the worker assumes that the frequency of the equipment used in 1972 was the same as cell phone frequency. He calculated the equipment transmitting a 4.8 watt output. Where Dr. Wakeem concluded, I assumed the radiation was the same as a cell phone band, I have no idea. At 10 gigahertz, the frequency was near cell phone bands when one considers the entire scope of the microwave band is from 0.3 gigahertz to 300 gigahertz. At best, his attribution of the words can be considered severely out of context. An expert would know the frequency of the transmission is critical to determine the size of the near field zone. Some authorities refer to the near field as extremely chaotic, and if power density is calculated on assumed values, the intensity of the exposure should be multiplied by 4. Which would have given an exposure of 126 watts per square meter. As a matter of reference, the typical cell phone in an urban setting generally operates at low power at around 0.3 watts per square meter. There are numerous other examples of Worksafe demonstrating the lack of understanding of the issue. One of the most egregious deviations from the due process is the WCAT vice chair creating their own evidence, not based on science, after I had made my submission, and I have not been allowed to test or require science to support her created facts about electromagnetic hypersensitivity. Creating her own understanding, not based on science, as she thoroughly slapped down any scientist I showed with qualifications in the field as little more than imbeciles with no or very little understanding of science. She and the review officer take particular issue with the opinions of epidemiologists, considering their science is no more than pseudoscience. In this, they are using similar arguments to those of tobacco companies used to claim cigarette smoking does not cause cancer. This information and much more has been offered to Mr. Trevor Hughes, ADM, responsible for WorkSafe, and Minister Bond with the responsibility for WorkSafe. Mr. Hughes has refused to look at the evidence, and Minister Bond has never responded. A full discussion of how WorkSafe WCAT has deviated from due process would take hours of video. More information can be provided by contacting me by email at worksafe@sios.ca. That's worksafe@sierraindigooscarsierra.ca. Minister Bond, Assistant Deputy Minister Trevor Hughes, you know the issues. My experience with WorkSafe and WCAT are not unique. You have not attempted to fix the problems. It is your inaction that has caused me to undertake a protest fast to bring the attention of the problems at WorkSafe to the public. The more I look at WorkSafe and WCAT, the more I realize that people are not being well served by an organization that operates on processes that would be more at home in a schoolyard bully's kangaroo court than in any court system we believe exists in Canada.